how versatile we are as a people and how you can go into business doing stuff that you like, because there's nothing worse than working 30 to 40 years doing stuff that you do not like. Am I right?
Yep.
All right, so before we go in, 20-second elevator pitch, each of you. Please, just a little bit about what you do and why you're here tonight.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
My name is Agina Abdul. I'm the owner of Twist and Turns Body Fitness. We provide yoga, Zumba, spinning classes in Northwest DC. We are in the community to teach our people that health and wellness is very, very important.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening. Dr. Walter Bowman, CEO of BM Elite Group. We are a real estate brokerage in which we specialize in residential, commercial, and flipping properties in distressed communities. So our motto is giving every client the elite experience, and that's what we do.
I'm Rob Boyd, Senior Director of WFG, which is a financial firm here in DC. And I'm also a co-founder of a university, which is actually a financial literacy program for youth. And mainly, I want to teach people the mentality that you have to have around your money, and also understanding how money works so that you can make sure it's working for you as hard as you're working for it.
Hello, I'm Nisa Harper. I'm originally from Alexandria, Virginia. I'm a writer. I have my BA in sociology, social work. So what I do basically is I help people discover or tap into their purpose as I also go on my journey. And I'm also a domestic violence prevention advocate. I'm a domestic violence survivor. I'm a rape survivor. I talk about the different experiences I've gone through and things that women can do to tap into who they are to live their best life while I'm still learning myself. Thanks.
All right. So let's get started. First question to the entrepreneurs. As everyone knows, when you're an employee, ideally you have a 40-hour work week, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, you get your weekends off. What is the life of an entrepreneur like? Who wants to answer that question first? I'll give the ladies a shot at this first. So it's between Nisa and Agina.
I would basically say that you don't get time off. You're your own brand promoter all the time. So that there's no, oh, I'll take a break here, because someone may see you, or you're going to be talking to someone. You constantly have to network. But I think what's key is what Sam talked about. When you're doing what you love, there's no greater feeling than that. Mm-hmm. But let's give a shout out to all the people who did what they didn't love to help us get through college or other things also.
Cool. Who wants to go next? Agina?
As the sister mentioned, as an entrepreneur, your hours are 24/7. But balance is very important. And I like to talk about balance, especially with, you know, health and wellness. I am a mother, so I have to have that balance of family and business, you know. So it's 24/7, but there are times where I might turn my phone off for an hour. And that's real, you know, because you have to have that clear mind. I have to sit and talk to my daughter, you know, without being interrupted all the time. And as an entrepreneur, my child understands this is what I do. So there might be sometimes she's with me at a night show, you know, talking about things. And she's going to be an entrepreneur because she's learned it now. So the balance is key, but there is 24/7.
Walter, please.
As an entrepreneur, when you find something that you're passionate about, it really doesn't feel like work. When you are an employee and you're doing something that is someone else's passion, you feel the work. So as an entrepreneur, I'm up 5 o'clock every morning and out of the house by 5:30, and I absolutely love what I do. I am in a position where someone doesn't tell me my self-worth and what I'm valued. I determine my own destination and my financial worth by building a base of clients that appreciate and that respect what we do, and it's just a wonderful thing. Right now I'm doing something that I love here almost midnight, and it doesn't even feel like work. I'm still energized. I can run outside and probably run 4 miles. I just love what I do, and it's a blessing to be in a position where you can not only touch the lives of the people in your immediate family, but build an organization in which you're training people to do the same thing so they can touch the lives of the people around them.
And I'm very appreciative of your presence here. Thank you so much. Rob?
I would say from a time perspective, as Walter said, it doesn't really feel like work, but mainly, and also to the balance point, is that whenever I wake up in the morning and I have like these affirmations and things that I tell myself to remind myself of what I'm going through and why, but going through that process, you realize that the time that you're investing is not only for you, but it's also for all the people that will come after you.
Yeah.
And so you realize that it's a sacrifice that you have to make that you wish someone would have made before you, but now you have the opportunity to make that sacrifice so that the people following you have a step up when they start, and they're not starting from where you started from. So mainly from a time perspective, you have to look at how you invest your time versus how you use it, and that's a difference maker, especially as I transition into entrepreneurship and understanding what my day-to-day look like and knowing that it's way more than 40 hours a week that goes into what I do. But because I love it, I'm not counting the hours.
Definitely. And speaking of investing, I think this was my money, seed money. So when you started, if you don't mind me asking and if you don't mind answering, this is a learning experience for everyone. When you started your own business, how did you go about from transitioning from, I would call it servitude of someone else to being your own person? You know, did you have money stacked up by any chance? Did you have to go to a bank for a loan? Describe that experience for me. Let's start with Walter.
Well, first of all, before I get into that, this young man, I taught at Banneker, and right now, I'm almost in tears and just being so proud of what he's doing right now and what he's accomplished. So everybody give it up for Sam. So getting into the question, for some reason I've always been an entrepreneur, period. I can remember in high school starting a bag lunch business in which, you know, I would dye red cars that were free lunch cars, and we would sell bag lunches, and I can easily make $75, $100 a week. And then I got my friends involved. So I've always been an entrepreneur at heart. Just to, you know, tell you my story so you can understand the paradigm shift into, you know, going from that E quadrant to that self-employed quadrant to that investor quadrant. I came to the area as an associate research scientist for NIH. After, you know, living in the South my entire life, I knew nothing outside of South Carolina. My cousins and I, we were the first to go to college. My mother literally picked cotton. That's what they did coming up. So we was the first to break that generational cycle of not being educated. So I came here fresh out of college, knew nothing about the city, worked at NIH for a year and absolutely hated it. My goal was to always go to medical school, but the reality kicked in. I didn't have the money for medical school. So, you know, what do you do next? One of my colleagues said, well, why don't you try teaching? So I started teaching at DeMatha Catholic High School and had a phenomenal year. From there, I realized that I really loved teaching. I was pretty good at it. And then I started teaching at Banneker, and then, you know, I did everything in education from an assistant principal, mathematics coordinator, teaching on the middle school, high school, even collegiate level. And in 2001, I started reading Robert Kiyosaki, Rich Dad, Poor Dad. A lot of y'all are probably familiar with him. And the one thing that transformed my life, period, is in order for me to be in a different space in life, I had to change my mentality. I had to understand what the rich was doing. I had to break the cycle of what they taught us. Go to school, go to college, get a good job, work for the, you know, white man for the rest of your life, get married and live life happily ever after. So going from an employee to a business owner was an easy transition because you do what you're passionate about, and that's the key thing. You gotta find that passion and that thing that drives you in real estate I'm just passionate about. And it's just a beautiful thing. It's an easy transition. Once you understand, you have to have a business plan. You just don't say, oh, I'm in business. And understanding the elements of that and understanding that there are models you follow that the successful have laid before you, you just have to make sure you implement those things. And it's an easy transition. Once you change your mental process, you study the rich, you study the wealthy, you study the Warren Buffetts, you study the Carlos Slims and so forth, And it just becomes a beautiful thing. So I hope I didn't take up too much time.
No, not at all.
I had to walk them through that transition.
That's a great story. Let's give Mr. Bowman another hand. Keep praying, Mr. Bowman. It's a force of habit. But Gina, please tell us about your journey as an entrepreneur.
So the same as my panelists, this is not my first time being an entrepreneur. You know, I had a moon bounce company in 2010. We did excellent for about 4 years. So entrepreneurship is about trying different things, if that's, you know, what you your goal. At this point, I also left my job last year. I was teaching at a school up the street, teaching yoga, a yoga instructor, and they wanted me to go back to school to get more education. And I already had my MBA, I had my bachelor's, I'm not going back to school right now. Unless you're gonna pay for it, you know, at that point. So as same thing, my husband said, do what you love. You know, the money's gonna come. You know, do what you love. So this is our first year going full time. I'm excited. And networking. So even things like this, you know, meeting this brother today, I wanna get into real estate. You know, my husband and I already been talking about this. So this is entrepreneurship, networking, meeting people, getting out in the community and really helping, you know. So that's my journey. I'm excited. And I like to say some of the same things. The books are very important. What you read, what you listen to, what's going in your mind, the music that you listen to. You know, we had segments about music. And yes, I love, you know, the UGK that we talked about and those kind of things. But there are times when you have to cut that stuff off sometimes. You have to really focus on what you're putting in your mind. So that's my journey briefly. Thank you.
So let's, I want to segue to another segment of this panel discussion. Let's talk about customer service, you know, because oftentimes, like you guys said, it's about networking and about building relationships. You as an entrepreneur, a business person, how do you go about creating those networks and maintaining those relationships so that people can come back to you and refer you to other customers?
Well, referrals is all my business. I don't cold call, I don't do anything of that nature. And so when I sit down with someone and teach them how the money game works, and as Walter said, knowing there's these quadrants, if those for you that aren't familiar, basically there's a cash flow quadrant that you have to understand and say, okay, who's making all the money and why? And but overall, when you're thinking about from a customer service perspective, if someone doesn't enjoy the experience that I give them as far as learning where to save your money, how much you need to save to reach your goals and to get to where you want to get to and be able to quit your job or buy that house or retire, whatever your goals may be, if you don't enjoy that experience and learn something, then you're probably not going to tell your friend or your cousin or your mom or your dad, and that's where my business stops and I don't eat. So I have to focus on the customer experience or the client experience, I would say, to say, okay, am I answering their questions as far as the things that they don't know or the things that they're curious about, or really most importantly, the things that they're afraid of? Because when I sit down with someone about their money, they're afraid of not ever living the life of their dream. And so when I can teach you how to do that, and show you how to start from exactly where you are right now, no matter where that may be, and teach you the basics to what you need to know, you tell everyone. And that's how my business grows. And so you really have to value the product, if you will. And if you're in real estate or someone like me in financial services, the product is actually the experience. But if you're if you do hair or if you do nails or whatever you may do, you have to make sure that your product is not only better than the next person's, but that the individual enjoyed getting that from you. And that's very key as far as making sure you have longevity in entrepreneurship. And just to kind of give a backstory to how I learned it the hard way, and it's so funny, when me and Sam first met is exactly when I became an entrepreneur. You did you covered the brunch for Capital Calls. Yep. And that was right when I quit my job, which was about 2 years ago. And the first couple of months in doing what I was doing, I had a couple of clients, but they weren't sending me friends and family, and it's very awkward to try to ask for that. And so I was like, okay, what's going on here? Can I really do this? And I had to shift the focus from what I wanted and what I needed as an individual to what people needed from me. and that changed everything. And so now, we have offices in multiple cities, and we have 46 licensed people that I've trained to teach other people about money and to help them take advantage of the right tools to get to where they want to get to in life. So that's what I would say is the key to entrepreneurship is making sure the individuals that you're serving enjoy the process.
I guess, so what I do is community work. And I had this thought process in the beginning, which I no longer have, that almost the equation that you do this because you love it and don't worry about the money. But I don't mind learning. I'm 40 years old. And so I had to learn, and I'm still learning. No, you need money, okay? I'm here to tell you that. But there is a way that you can still keep your integrity, serve the community if that's what you do, and still live and survive. But you have to learn that. I've read Think and Grow Rich, and I need to read that again. But it is those books. Rich Dad, Poor Dad. You have to look at all these different models that we've been shown, different people, whether it's hip hop, whether it's, you know, writing, whether it's real estate, and just figure out, okay, there is a blueprint. How am I going to follow it? And then how am I going to make this with my niche? Whatever your niche is, because everybody has a niche, but you still have to market it. And so when it comes to people, because I do a lot of community things, what people don't understand a lot of times is it's not always a camera on you. And it's not always someone taking a picture of you. But when you pass that person, whether you're at the bus stop or you're on Capitol Hill at the Congressional Black Caucus, whatever it is, you don't know who they know, just like they don't know who you know. So a lot of times you can get in the habit of, unless I know what that person does, I may not speak to them, or I may not tell them, you know, I may not try to rush and give them my book. Like some people see Oprah and they'll, oh, let me rush and go get Oprah my book. That's great, that is what you want to do. But you may not know Sam's name, and he's somebody else you need to give your book. So it's like just treating people, literally treating people like everyone is somebody, because they are. The guys in my neighborhood, and this is my last thing, the guys in my neighborhood, I live in Congress Heights, and people think I'm crazy because they say, oh, I live in Congress Heights. And I did just move there. But I'm a firm believer. This is what I do. This is what I was put here to do. No different from Ayanna, no different from Wayne Dyer. This is my calling. But at the same time, everybody in this room has a calling and a gift. So like the guys in my neighborhood, they hang out at the liquor store. I'm like, hey, sure, I may be walking through the weed or whatever they're smoking. It doesn't matter. So I think that with the customer service, you have to really understand everybody is somebody. And you may not get something from them. They may give you something. And if you can't see that, no matter what, you're going to have, like Rob said, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so like Rob said, you can literally stop your own food coming into your mouth. So I think customer service, just that's a basic thing you should just do.
Perfect. So my next question, and I think this will be my final question before we open up to the audience. I really want a brother and a sister to come to the front and prepare to ask a question of these panelists. I think it's very important that we take advantage of these opportunities, because this doesn't come around but so often, and I think it's important that we continue to educate ourselves and become better people. With that being said, I want you guys to think about those dreadful times as an employee of somebody else. Just think back to those, you know, those nights we had cold sweats, you know. What lessons did you learn from your time as an employee that helped you become a better boss? Keeping in mind that you may not have your own employees as well, but you know, what lessons did you learn working for somebody else that you took with you on your journey?
Well, that's a good question. And right now, the first thing that comes to mind is I can hear Stephen A. Smith kind of getting very adamant about this. When you are working for somebody else, you are working for somebody else. You can't do what you want to do. You can't say what you want to say. Even though it may be a better product, even though it may be a better way, you are the product of someone else. As a teacher, my work ethic was no different. 5 o'clock every morning, I was always the first teacher in the building, always was there to set up for my day. If my students did an assignment, it was my job to get it back to them in 24 hours so I can assess how well they did on the assignment, what I need to reteach. I was one of those teachers that other teachers didn't like because they thought I was doing the most and I was just doing my job, to be truthful of the matter. And I say that humbly with all humility. So even being a teacher, with, you know, having to teach to the test and not teach my African-American or African boys that, look, yeah, we talking about the stuff in the book, but let's first talk about self-respect. Let's first understand that you're not coming in here with your pants down and your shirt not tucked in. I don't care what you do outside these doors, but you're not doing that in here. And being firm in that and standing in that, and then having someone to be counterproductive to that to say, oh, you're too hard on the kids. I always had a problem with that because these are not your kids, these are my students, and I took pride in that. I took that to be my social and my responsibility as someone that they looked at as a role model. So in being an employee, it was very heartbreaking to understand that people just didn't have the same level of care and the same level of passion that you had to just deliver the best product possible. And when I understood that people didn't respect that, it just makes being an entrepreneur that much more powerful because I now can go in school as a CEO and not a teacher because they're now on my agenda. I can now go in schools and say what I want to say to my African boys about, don't get it twisted, you too can be your own business owner and understand the power in that and not be on someone else's agenda. So that becomes a very powerful thing when you are not the employee, you are the business owner and the investor, and you're on your own agenda with delivering an excellent product and not having to be held to mediocrity because someone doesn't want to step up to that level.
Perfect. Let's, Gina, answer this question before we turn it to the audience question. So what lessons did you learn in those dreadful times as an employee that helped you further your potential as an entrepreneur?
I would say work ethic and compassion. And I say compassion because we do have teachers that teach at our studio. So I do have employees. And the compassion comes in when you understand that they also have families, you know, that someone's child may be sick one day. Those kind of things you have to take from being an employee. Understand that someone tells you you can't take off work if your child is sick. But your employee tells me, if my employee tells me that their child is sick, I understand that. It's compassion. And the work ethic, you know, being to work on time. If you have that at work, you have to have it in business. You have to be there on time. You have to be, if I say I'm going to call you at 12 o'clock, I'm going to call you at 12 o'clock. You know, so that work ethic is really important.
So I got a special question for you. You mentioned compassion and just helping employees out or being lenient when they have emergencies. How do you sift through the legitimate emergencies and I guess the excuses? Like if an employee just didn't feel like getting up that morning and they're just like, you know what, I'm just going to make up an excuse. I've always been curious about that with my employers, you know.
Well, I think definitely as a female, you know, being a female entrepreneur, people will try you, you know. Even if it is another female, they might see what they can get away with. So as an employer, it's still those limits, you know. If you call out today, you're not calling out next week as well, you know what I mean? And then it will be, you gotta go, you know, because it's a business. So if I have customers coming in and they're expecting you to be there and you're not there every other week, that's a problem. So, you know, it still has to be that balance again of the compassion, but also that this is a business and I'm counting on you, you know, to be there.
Oh, right, sure. Matter of fact, let's open it up to everyone.
Well, I would say I had one job after I finished at Howard, and I did research and I did that for about 2 or 3 years. And the thing that I dreaded the most, I'll never forget this day. And this is really honestly why I'm an entrepreneur right now. One morning I woke up, it was the day after Christmas, and I had to go to work. And in my mind, I was thinking to myself, like, I'd rather be with my family right now. I'd rather be in North Carolina, which is where I'm originally from. I'd rather be down there with my brothers and my mom and enjoying the holidays, but yet I have to come back to work because I didn't have vacation days. So I'm sitting there at my desk and thinking to myself, like, why isn't anyone else here? And I know I used up all my vacation time to that point, so I had to be here, had to be there. But the thing that struck me the most is that my managers or my supervisors weren't there when I was there working. And that's the day I really understood the value of leadership. And that day when I was sitting there doing, I really wasn't doing anything, but the fact that I had to be there just rubbed me the wrong way. And that day after Christmas, I decided that next summer, I'm gonna quit my job. And that was Christmas of 2012. And I decided that the summer of 2013, I was gonna walk away from this and I would never work for anybody ever again. And that was all because I was in that moment sitting there and I was like, where's everybody who's supposed to be telling me what to do? And I really realized how important leadership was. And I wanted to one day be a leader that led people the right way instead of saying, hey, go to work, but I'm still on vacation. And that was the day that changed everything. And from there, I went on like a 6 month, like no BS, goal driven, gotta quit this summer, or gotta be prepared to quit. And I know you asked that before, and we really didn't answer the question, but I had saved up to quit and to be prepared financially to make that transition. But one thing I realized is that I really didn't need that preparation, or it wasn't the money I needed to be prepared to quit, it was the mentality that I needed to transition it and to be a self-starter, get up every day when nobody's telling me I gotta be at my desk at a certain time. But now I know I'm doing something I like to do, so I don't need an alarm clock to get me up and get me there. I just need something that I care about. And it just changes your whole perspective on what you want to do. But either way, long story short, leadership was the one thing that was missing in my work, in my employee life, that I wanted to make sure I brought to the business aspect of what I do as far as teaching other people how to be entrepreneurs. Because I only have one employee now, and she's my assistant. But everybody else that I work with is independent. I'm just showing you how to do business.
No, that's right. Nisa, please.
So let's see, the question again was, what is that moment? Okay, so I would say I've led up until this point, a pretty interesting life. I worked in factory, I've worked a lot of jobs. But I used to work at Target, and I was in corporate America, behind closed doors. So I had this supervisor who just did not like me. And she used to yell at everybody, literally. And so one day I went into her office because, you know, I'd just been raised a certain way and you say what you need to say in a respectful way. And I was going to let her know because I just knew once I told her, she was going to, it was going to click for her and she was going to change. Yeah, that's what I thought. So I said, oh, can I talk to you? And she looked at me like, I don't even like you. And so, I never did anything to my supervisor. They said it was more, other people tell me it was more of a, I had already had my degree and everything. I was working at Target. I really liked the job I had. It was low paying, but I was doing customer service and I love people. So anyway, people were telling me it was more of a personality thing. So I said, oh, I need to talk to you. She looked at me and I said, yeah, I really don't, I closed the door. I really don't think it's appropriate how you yell at everybody in here. That's not how you should be talking to employees. She looked at me like I had horns coming out of my head, like, what is this? Who is she talking to? And she looked at me, she was like, are you done? And I said, I am. And so, you know, basically, she just really reinforced to me, no matter what the situation, no matter how stressful it is, because I did get promoted right under her, like 3 months later, and I was working in human resources by that time. She just really kind of reinforced to me, no matter what the situation, again, what my motto, you just treat people like you want to be treated, regardless of how stressful your job is, regardless of what's going on at home, regardless of so many things. You treat people like you want to be treated. And she kind of reinforced to me like, yeah, this ain't for you. But that's not exactly when I started writing books and doing certain things and speaking about different topics. But that was, she was, Karen, was someone that has stayed in my memory of, it's not for me, that's all.
Shout out to Karen.
Right.
All right, so it's time for audience Q&A, and it's a special treat. The two people, the brother and the sister, who gets to ask the question, they get to sit in the chair like they're the host. So who's going? Chanel, come on, let's take it. Chanel, then after her, the gentleman right here. All right, so.
Good evening, and thank all of you guys for coming here tonight. All right, so I have a million and one questions, but since we only have time for one, that means each one of you are going to get my contact information after this. I have yours already. I have a very well-versed background in customer service, in sales. Right now, I'm a recruiting manager for a communications company. And I look at life every day as some form of a transaction, whether it's monetary or an exchange of ideas or conversation, it's still some sort of a transaction. And you guys touched up on the transition, and that's one thing that I'm battling with right now. I don't want to get so overwhelmed with remote emotion that I'm like, you know what, I quit, I'm out of here. Because I do love what I do, and I'm learning the skills that I'm learning on my job as a recruiting manager and working in sales every day. I know for a lot of entrepreneurs, it's always different. Some people are just like, wake up one day, you know what, I'm done, and I start my multi-million dollar empire. And some make sort of a smoother transition and prepare themselves. What advice would you give to not just me, but other entrepreneurs out there to, I guess, kind of make the best decision for their craft and what they're doing to make a successful transition?
Two things about successful entrepreneurs when they make the transition. One, they either have wealthy parents that can back them financially, or two, as Rob stated, you have to plan for the transition. You just don't wake up one day and say, oh, I quit my job, and then you just jump into making money that very same day. As you transition, you have to have a business plan. If you don't have a business plan, you don't have specific measurable, identified goals that you're targeting every day, every quarter, every, you know, biannual basis, you have to have that plan in place, and you have to have a plan in place that you can measure and constantly evaluate. So if you don't have wealthy parents that can say, here's $100,000 to help you start that business, you have to plan for it.
And that money will go.
Exactly. And I would have to agree with Rob on that.
Oh,